Good morning everyone and welcome to the class. We are doing the chapter The Making of the National Movement 1870s to 1947, and in this chapter we have done the foundation of Congress, Indian National Congress, in December 1885, and then we are doing how was the objective and method of Congress party, the Indian National Congress, in the first 20 years of its establishment. So till 1905 we find that the Congress was moderate in its objectives and methods, and we have discussed about this in the previous class, that what do we mean by being moderate in objectives and being moderate in methods. Okay, so we have seen that the Congress demanded that there should be more Indians in the government and in the administration of the country. It also wanted that the legislative councils should be made more representative, it should be given more power, and it should also be introduced in those provinces where it was not existing, because there were some provinces in which we find these legislative councils were there, which were partly a representative body, but in all the provinces these were not existing. So their first demand was that these legislative councils should be there in all the provinces, they should be made more powerful, they should be made more representative. Okay, and they also demanded that Indians should be placed in high position in the government, and they demanded that civil services examination, which used to be held in London at that time, they demanded that this examination should be held in India also. So they wanted Indianization of administration. So what were the demands of the Congress? We are discussing this. Indianization of administration. Indianization of administration, it means that there should be more Indians in the administrative jobs, in the on the important jobs. At that time only Britishers used to hold the important administrative jobs, and this was a sign of racism, because the whites were considered to be superior than the blacks. The Europeans were considered to be superior than the Indians. That is why the higher posts in administration was not given to Indians, it was given to Europeans only. But this was the demand of the Congress, that these higher position jobs should be given to Indians also, because then there can be talk of equality, then only we can think of being equal. Not only this, there were one more reason, because if British officers were, Britishers were holding the important administrative jobs, so they were sending a major part of their large salaries to their home. You know, because they were living here alone and their family was in Britain, so whatever was their salary was very huge. A huge amount was given to them in salary, because we are talking about higher post jobs in administration. So what they did, they sent a large amount of their salary to London. So that was what? That was we can say it was a drain of wealth. The wealth of India was going to Britain. So it will also be stopped if the higher posts are given to Indians. Then there will not be drain of wealth from India to England. So that will also be stopped. So that is the reason we find that the Congress demanded that there should be Indianization of administration. Other than this, the demands of Congress also included that there should be separation of judiciary from executive. As you have read about separation of power in civics in chapter 1, that is one of the most important features of our constitution, that our constitution makers have adopted this separation of power, this doctrine of separation of power, which means that all the three organs of the government will be separated from each other. There will not be a fusion of power, we can say. This prohibits the misuse of power. Actually, what happens that the two organs start checking the power of the other organ. In this way, this checks, because of these checks, there is a balance is maintained. No one is in a condition to misuse its powers. So now the demand from this Congress was there should be separation of judiciary from the executive, and it also demanded repeal of the Arms Act. Repeal of Arms Act, what does it mean? Repeal means repeal ka matlab hua it should be taken back. The Arms Act, which was passed by the British, which was against the interest of the Indians, so Congress was also demanding that this Arms Act should be taken back by the British. Isko khatam kar diya jaye, isko repeal kar diya jaye. And it also demanded freedom of speech and expression, which was curtailed by the Vernacular Press Act, about which we have discussed earlier also. So these were the demands of Congress. And we find that in the early years, the Congress also raised some economic issues, like it was of the opinion, the Congress was of the opinion that the British rule led to the poverty and famines. The British rule is responsible for poverty in India, for famines in India. The British rule has increased the land revenue, and this increase in land revenue had caused the has caused miserable conditions of peasants and zamindars also. And the British are exporting. They are exporting the grains to Europe, which has created food shortage in India. So the British were responsible for so many economic problems the country was facing at that time, according to Congress. And the Congress demanded that there must be reduction of revenue, so that the peasants and the zamindars can be benefited. And then the Congress also demanded that there should be cut in military expenditure. The huge portion of the revenue which was taken by the people of India was spent on military expenditure. So it was the demand of the Congress that military expenditure should be curtailed, and instead of spending on military, there should be spending on irrigation sources. There should be spending on creating the new sources of irrigation. So these were the demand, and we find that so many resolutions were passed by the Congress on the salt tax, then the treatment of Indian laborers abroad, like we have seen so many people who, like the landless laborers, the tribals, they went to different countries as plantation workers on contract, so but their condition was very difficult there. So now the Congress was also demanding that they should be treated in a well manner in at abroad, and the Congress also included in the list of its demand the suffering of forest dwellers, because we find that there was forest administration started by the British, and this forest administration was interfering in the lives of the tribals, so which was not liked by the tribals. So it was also included in the demand list of the Congress. And we find that Congress was, as we have discussed earlier also, Congress was only a body of educated elite, the English speaking class of India. That was a very small class at that time. People belonging to this caste only were the members of Congress. And Congress came into existence for the purpose of promoting the purpose of British only. As we have seen, it was founded by the leaders in this hope that the Congress will present the demands of the people of India in front of the British government, and accordingly the British government will bring changes, and in this way the rule of British in India will prolong. But now we are finding that though the Congress was an organization of English speaking people only, it did not talk only on behalf of professional groups or zamindars or industrialists, but it was slowly, it was we can say the base of the Congress was really widening. And we find that there were moderate leaders in Congress who wanted to develop public awareness about the unjust nature of British rule, the British rule which was totally unjust. So these leaders demanded that there should be public awareness. People must know about the unjust nature of the British rule. How the people will know this? Obviously, people will know about the unjust nature of British rule through newspapers, through magazines, through pamphlets. And that is the reason we find that these leaders also demanded and supported the freedom of expression and speech. There must be freedom of expression and speech, then only people will become aware of the unjust nature of the British rule. Okay, and these early leaders, these moderate leaders, the leaders who believed in moderate objective and techniques, they were known as moderate leaders. So these moderate leaders, they published newspapers, they wrote articles, and they wanted to prove, they wanted to show how British rule was responsible for the economic ruin of the country.
Ruin means
devastation, the economic problems the country was facing. So for all these, who was responsible? The British were responsible. Okay, so these leaders, they criticized British rule in their speeches, and they sent representatives to different parts of the country so that a particular public opinion against the government can be formed and people can be mobilized on those issues. And they felt that the British had respect for the ideals of freedom and justice, because and by that time in Britain we find that democracy was established. So it was felt by these leaders that the British respect the ideal of freedom and justice, and so they must accept the just demands of Indians also. If they have established democracy in their own country, now it is their responsibility to accept the just demands of the people of India in order to spread that idea of democracy, that spread that idea of equality, idea of freedom, idea of justice. So they felt that the early leaders of the Congress felt that if we put our demands, if we present our demands in front of the British, that is sufficient to bring change in the British government. Anna? And in their opinion, it was necessary to express these demands, make demands in front of the government. Anna? Make the government aware of the feelings of the Indians. So this was the moderate, these were the views of the moderate leaders of Congress. And now we find that slowly in Congress, some leaders started to raise question about the style of working of the Congress. They were not liking the way the Congress was working. This is the moderate way. It was moderate in its objective. It was moderate in its method. So there was a group. This group started to arise from 1890s only, which was not liking the moderate leaders, which were not liking the objective and methods of the moderate leaders. And in these leaders, three names are very much important, and that is Lal, Bal and Pal. You can remember it very well. It's Lal, Bal and Pal. Now, what is the full form of all these? Lal is for Lala Lajpat Rai. Bal is for, not as, Bal Ganga Dhar Tilak. Bal Ganga Dhar Tilak, and Pal is for Bipin Pal. Okay, so these were the Bipin Chandra Pal. These were the three leaders. Lal, Bal and Pal. Now we see this Lala Lajpat Rai, he belongs to Punjab. Bal Gangadhar Tilak. Bal Gangadhar Tilak, he belonged to Maharashtra. Okay. And Bipin Chandra Pal, he belonged to Bengal. So these were the important leaders who started to disliking the method and the moderate method and moderate objectives of the Congress. And we see that they started to explore more radical objectives and methods. They were not liking moderate methods and objectives. Instead, they wanted to explore some radical objectives and methods. Now The term is radical. As I told you, the meaning of this moderator in the similar way, we must understand the meaning of radical.
Radical in objectives and methods.
So, in the next class, we will continue with this. We will understand the meaning of radical and the subsequent content will be discussed.